Hello and welcome to our in-depth special where we look at issues beyond the headlines and focus on them to find out the complexity of the issue. Today our focus is on the national capital. That's right, Delhi. The national capital is rapidly becoming the country's corona capital, crumbling under the steeply rising coronavirus cases and the pressure on its healthcare infrastructure. Though Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal has reiterated today that he will follow the Lieutenant Governor's order to open up the capital's hospitals for non-Delhiites, the move is sure to increase the burden on the city's already overwhelmed facilities. The big question in in-depth today is Delhi prepared? And why is Delhi so difficult to manage in a corona crisis? It's our top focus today on in-depth.
15 जुलाई को दिल्ली में 33,000 बेड्स की जरूरत पड़ेगी दिल्ली वालों के लिए, 31 जुलाई को 80,000 बेड्स की जरूरत पड़ेगी दिल्ली के अस्पतालों में। 50% लोग दिल्ली के बाहर से आके इलाज कराते हैं। 15 जुलाई को दिल्ली के वालों के लिए 33,000 बेड चाहिए तो सारे मिला के बाहर वाले भी अगर मिलाएंगे तो 65,000 बेड्स की जरूरत पड़ेगी, और 31 जुलाई को 80,000 बेड अगर दिल्ली वालों के लिए चाहिए तो लगभग 1.5 लाख टोटल बेड्स की ज़रूरत पड़ेगी। बहुत ज़्यादा बड़ी चुनौती है, आसान काम नहीं है।
Certainly the challenge is huge and unprecedented. With the country's financial capital Mumbai already struggling, the deadly pandemic has now hit the political capital hard, and the peak is yet to come.
आने वाले समय में दिल्ली में कोरोना बहुत तेजी से फैलने वाला है। 15 जून को उम्मीद है कि 44,000 केस हो जाएंगे, जो आज 31,000 केस हैं। ऐसा अनुमान है कि 15 जून तक 44,000 केस हो जाएंगे, 30 जून तक 1 लाख केस हो जाएंगे, 15 जुलाई तक 2.25 लाख केस हो जाएंगे और 31 जुलाई तक लगभग 5,32,000 केस हो जाएंगे दिल्ली में।
So is Delhi prepared to handle this daunting task? Delhi currently has just 8,821 hospital beds, 582 ICU beds, 468 ventilator beds, and 3,590 beds with oxygen facility in COVID hospitals. And raising beds here on is going to be a Herculean task. To meet the challenge, the AAP government plans to link big hospitals to 27, 5 or 4-star hotels with upper price cap of 10,000 rupees per day per bed. While 8 hotels hospitals have already been linked to act as extended COVID hospitals, the district magistrates are now in the process of linking 19 others. This is expected to increase the capacity by another 2,000 beds by the 15th of June. To further ease the pressure on overwhelmed facilities, Delhi plans to follow Mumbai's example and convert several stadiums as COVID care centres. A Delhi government panel constituted by Lieutenant Governor Anil Baijal has made this recommendation to tackle the surge.
Let's break down which locations could be turned into hospitals. You have the Pragati Maidan, which is in the list of grounds and stadiums that can be converted into hospitals. You also have the famous Talkatora Stadium, indoor stadium in Delhi. Besides that, there's the Thyagaraj Stadium also, again an indoor stadium where many sporting events are all conducted. You have the Indira Gandhi Indoor Stadium, that's also part of this particular list where perhaps hospital beds could be put up. The iconic Jawaharlal Nehru Stadium could also be converted into a COVID center temporarily. You also have the Dhyan Chand National Stadium in the national capital, which is also being considered at this point.
So the possibility now exists that stadiums in the national capital could be converted into makeshift corona centers. Remember, the coronavirus cases in Delhi have been rising steeply over the last fortnight, adding more than 1,500 cases virtually a day, breaching the 31,000 mark on Tuesday. There has been speculation also of community transmission in the national capital, and of course a back and forth between the lieutenant governor and the Aam Aadmi Party government. A grim picture is being painted at the moment of the COVID crisis in the capital. Take a look.
On 7th June, the Delhi Chief Minister had announced that Delhi hospitals would only admit COVID patients from Delhi. Then on 8th of June, Lieutenant Governor Anil Baijal ordered authorities to ensure that treatment is not denied to any patient on grounds of not being a resident of Delhi.
You see, this order violated the constitutional right to equality and right to life, which includes right to health.
And on Wednesday morning, the Delhi Chief Minister laid all speculation to rest, deciding to abide by the Lieutenant Governor's order without any further debate or discussion.
केंद्र सरकार ने निर्णय ले लिया, एलजी साहब ने आदेश पारित कर दिया, ये समय असहमतियों का समय नहीं है, ये समय एक दूसरे से डिफर करने का समय नहीं है, अब जो निर्णय हो गया केंद्र सरकार का, एलजी साहब ने जो आदेश दे दिया, उसको लागू किया जाएगा।
With this announcement, the age-old tussle between the Delhi government and the LG was laid to rest, at least for the time being. But it is not just the LG. The Delhi government's decision to restrict admission to Delhi's hospitals for outsiders invited criticism from all quarters.
अभी आवश्यकता है कि डर के उस माहौल को खत्म करने का, ये बताने का कि कोरोना पॉजिटिव अगर आप हुए हैं, तो इतनी हेल्थ इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर की कैपेसिटी होनी चाहिए, उसका इतना एम्पावरमेंट होना चाहिए कि ट्रैकिंग हो, टेस्टिंग हो और ट्रीटमेंट हो।
While every government establishment has been denying it, the Delhi government became the first state government to point towards community transmission of COVID having already taken place.
कल एम्स के डायरेक्टर ने खुद कहा था कि दिल्ली के कंटेनमेंट जोन्स में कम्युनिटी स्प्रेड है, परंतु क्योंकि टेक्निकल इशू है और इसके बारे में फैसला केंद्र सरकार ही कर सकती है, वही बता सकते हैं कि कम्युनिटी स्प्रेड है या नहीं। हम तो कैसे स्प्रेड है, हम तो ये कह सकते हैं भाई स्प्रेड है, दिल्ली में बढ़ रहा है, बहुत तेजी से बढ़ रहा है। अब उसका वर्ड जो कम्युनिटी स्प्रेड वर्ड यूज करने की अधिकार तो केंद्र सरकार के पास, वही बता पाए।
बट व्हाट इज द स्टेटस ऑफ कोविड ट्रांसमिशंस इन द कंट्री? About one third of the country's population inside various containment zones and hotspots may already have been infected with the novel coronavirus and may have recovered, revealed preliminary findings of the Indian Council of Medical Research, ICMR's population-based sero survey. Highly placed sources claim that the report, which is yet to be published, states that between 15 to 30% of the population has been exposed to the infection within containment zones and hotspots.
So as a country, to say that there is community spread happening would not be a right statement. On the other hand, I do think that in the hotspots or in the containment area where the number of cases is increasing significantly, some degree of local transmission, which you could say community transmission in these area, is quite likely. And that is what is accounting for this increased number of cases. And what it really highlights is that we need to be very aggressive in these areas, and we need to have a strategy so that we break this community transmission and have very aggressive containment strategy in these areas.
According to sources, the findings of the ICMR sero survey have already been shared with the Union Cabinet Secretary and the PMO. But the ICMR in a tweet stated that the reports in the media are speculative as the survey results are yet to be finalized. Whatever the findings of the survey may be about community transfer, there is no denying that the cases of COVID in India is still rising in leaps and bounds, as thousands more get infected every single day.
So let's raise the questions that go beyond simply the Aam Aadmi Party versus LG rhetoric. Is Delhi NCR the most unmanageable part of India today? Does Delhi NCR need a single chain of authority? Remember, the National Capital Region, as it's now called. I'm joined by the former Lieutenant Governor of Delhi, Najib Jung. Appreciate your joining us, Mr. Jung. Would I be right in saying that because of the nature of Delhi with the NCR as part of the NCR region, it is very difficult to manage. There are multiple authorities, each of whom are accountable to very different power centers. Some are accountable to the state, some to the center, some to different state governments.
Rajiv, let's understand that like many other national capitals, Delhi is a hybrid. And the intent to keep it a hybrid actually started in 1947 itself with the Sitaramaiya Committee report. And there was great debate between Jawaharlal Nehru, Ambedkar and so on, how it should go. To cut a long story short, this debate has been going on. And initially, if you recall, in the 50s and very early 60s, the mayor of Delhi was a very important entity. And we had legendary mayors like Barrister Nuruddin, Lala Shamnath, who actually had tremendous stature in Delhi. So the mayor in Delhi counted for a lot. And that was a large municipality. Subsequent to that, because the political ambitions of political parties came in, we had the Metropolitan Council, and then the Metropolitan Council more or less forced the hand of the central government into making Delhi a union territory without with legislature. Now, here is where the confusion comes. Because now you have a chief minister with truncated powers. You have a lieutenant governor who controls the land, the police, and the civil services. You have you had a municipality that was looking after various things. About 5-6 years ago, they demolished that municipality and made it into 3 municipalities. The municipalities are financially broke. Mm-hmm. They are dependent on the Delhi government for funding. And because the municipalities have the party in power is a different party from the party ruling Delhi, the funds are often blocked. So you have the eastern municipality, which is completely broke. You have north municipality, which barely survives by the skin of the teeth. And you have the southern municipality, which is fine. Mm-hmm. So unless we can think out of the box now, this confusion will reign. Because the municipalities have the function of cleaning.
But you know, Mr. Jung, in this particular context, taking out from what you're saying about these different power centers or different centers of authority, you have MCD hospitals today, you have state government hospitals, you have central government hospitals. The central government hospitals, in a way, are responsible to are possibly responsible to the health ministry. You have the state government hospitals, which are responsible to the Kejriwal government, and you have the MCD hospitals. So the question is, can an Arvind Kejriwal today rein in a central government hospital? He cannot. And that, in a sense, does it reveal the limitations of this multiplicity of authorities?
Very frankly speaking, in an emergency like this, all resources should have been pulled in. So I don't think that there's much of a problem. The central government is fully aware of the issue and should have a first-rate hospital. Mr. Kejriwal should be running first-rate government hospital. Mm-hmm. The municipalities, I'm afraid, mm-hmm. really afraid of their ability to manage the hospitals well. Now, insofar as Delhi government hospitals are concerned, the confusion lies here, not so much with the other hospitals. And I would imagine that the complaints we are getting of patients being turned away, of testing not being done, Mr. Kejriwal should put in revenue officers in these government hospitals to take charge, to see that patients that come in actually help the doctors. The doctors are hard pressed. They can hardly manage their own affairs rather than checking in patients and running ambulances and so on. I can't understand why Delhi government can't have a single number with hundreds of helplines. And when the phone call comes, mm-hmm. then the ambulance goes and the ambulance knows exactly which hospital is there with a free bed.
No, but are you saying every hospital, whether central, state, municipal, therefore has one authority, one IAS officer or one bureaucrat who handles that hospital is responsible for it?
I'm not saying an IAS officer, that would raise the level, but certainly a tehsildar or a NAIB tehsildar should be there. A couple of them should be there in big hospitals. They should ensure that the patients are wheeled in to a certain comfort. It's happening in other places. Administrations cannot only depend on doctors in this crisis. The civil servants have to pool in their resources with their presence in hospitals.
Okay, that's a very important point that you're making there, Mr. Jung. Just one very quick final question to you. Do you therefore believe that the LG and Mr. Kejriwal now should, in a way, pool their resources, as the Chief Minister said, and there should be one task force that meets every day?
Well, that goes without saying, Rajdeep, and why only Mr. Kejriwal and why only the LG? The central government should have a nodal officer along with these authorities, and this task force must meet every day, ensure that the ambulances are running perfectly, that information is disseminated perfectly, so that people know where they are going today. Apart from the fear of the disease, is the larger fear that where would I go? I don't know, for instance, where I can be tested. I have no idea. I don't know if I'll be turned away. I'm a 70-year-old man. I don't know if I'll be turned away, where I'll go, how I'll be treated, and therefore you expect me to run to a private hospital and spend lakhs of rupees. Maybe I can do it, maybe I can't. So it's really up to the government to have these helplines published in newspapers. One number to give you 100 helplines.
Right.
One number to take you where you want to go.
So in a way, because the Delhi government has an app, you don't believe that the app in itself is good enough, is it, Mr. Jung?
Well, I have been reading in the papers, and I think...
There are flaws in it. The Chief Minister admitted there are flaws in it. But do you believe that, you know, in a city of the size of, sprawling size of Delhi, where a number of people live on the margins, is an app enough? Are you saying a helpline number is enough? And will private hospitals also be involved in this fight?
Look, an app is a presumption that everyone has a smartphone. We are a poor country. Come on. I mean, I have servants at home. They don't have smartphones. They have regular phones, the old Nokia model. So let's not look at apps. But a number can be called from an ordinary phone. So an app has its limitations in a poor country. But a regular number doesn't have those limitations. And of course, the private hospital must and absolutely must succumb to government guidelines at this point. If they don't, they should be punished, and punished severely. I can't understand. I saw a WhatsApp going around yesterday from a private hospital quoting absurd figures and quoting a government order. Now, obviously, that government order was a fraud order on behalf of this hospital, creating a fraud that we are allowed to charge XYZ. Today, that hospital should be shut down.
Right.
Their superintendent or whoever owns the hospital should be in jail. That's the kind of salutary punishment that we must be giving these people right now.
And that should include both private and government hospitals. Am I clear? Because the government of Delhi has decided to take over some of these hospitals. Gangaram, Moolchand are being taken over. Should private hospitals also, in an emergency, come under the writ of the Delhi government or the centre?
I don't think government is capable of running private hospitals the way private hospitals run. No. Government should do its job by running its own hospitals competently. They are unclean. They are hardly able to manage the good services. They should concentrate there. Let the private hospitals be supervised properly and let them do their job.
Okay. Those are firm, strong words coming from a former Lieutenant Governor of Delhi, Mr. Najib Jung. Thank you so much for taking out the time and giving us a sense of what you believe needs to be done to fix the national capital. That's right. Fixing the national capital is going to become a big challenge in the days ahead as patients and relatives move from hospital to hospital in search of beds and the number of coronavirus cases rise. We'll, of course, continue to focus on these and other issues in depth over the next few days. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.
Hi everyone, Preeti Chaudhary here. Hope you like this video. For latest news and analysis, like and subscribe to the India Today YouTube channel. And don't forget to press the bell icon to stay updated. Thank you for watching.